So, hi everyone. We can start. So today, our speaker is Ilias Zadik.
Yeah.
I don't know if it's
yeah.
Presentation. From here, actually.
Yeah.
So, we will talk about the planted clique one.
Yeah, thank you very much. Okay, so... Yeah, so thanks everybody for being here. So I'm actually just a postdoc fellow at the Center for Data Science of NYU. And what I'm going to talk about will be joint work with David Gamarnik from MIT. So David, can you hear me? It's like working.
It's just for the recording.
Yeah, yeah, so like there's no way to test
it.
Okay, so let's keep it like this. Hopefully it's working. Okay. So this is joint work with David Gamarnik at MIT. So David used to be my PhD advisor until I graduated this September. So it's actually some work that is in my thesis, so it's sort of great to share with you some work from there. Okay, so what will be the topic? So the topic will be the planted clique model. So the planted clique model is a model that has been analyzed, interestingly, from very different fields. So probability theory, discrete probability theory have been really a topic of interest, but also theoretical computer science and statistics. So it sort of bridges this sort of different, let's say, paths, and I think this has a distinct interest in it. So I will talk about specifically some landscapes, some geometric results for the planted clique model. And that mostly concern dense subgraphs. So we will see what exactly mean by this. And most importantly, some property that actually originates in spin class theory, at least the inspiration for it, which is called overlap gap property. And we will see essentially how, properly defined, of course, how does it come inside the planted clique model. Okay, so let me start. So I will start with some sort of folklore results in random graph theory to make sure we all understand where we are. So David Matulla at 1972 and later independently Grimmett and McDiarmid at 75, they discussed the following sort of quite folklore and standard result. So they took an instance of an Erdős-Rényi random graph. So that's a G and half. So that means, okay, let's, you know, that's an important concept, so let's make sure we know what the G and half is. So G and half is the following random graph model. So it's a it's a distribution of the undirected graphs on n vertices. So what you do is you take n vertices, and for each possible edge, for every 2 points, you flip a coin independently with probability half. Okay? So you just flip a coin independently with probability half, and you do this for every possible pair of vertices, and the final outcome is an instance of a G and half. And you know, of course, this induces a distribution over the space of undirected graphs on n vertices, and it's actually the uniform distribution. So it's like a very simple and sort of standard distribution. So you can naturally ask the question, what is the largest clique in an instance of this graph? So what's a clique? A clique is a fully connected subgraph. So you want the largest m, natural number m, so that there exists a subset here of vertex size cardinality m, which is fully connected, all the edges are present. So that's a pattern, and you can naturally ask when does this pattern, how large m does this pattern appear? And we know this exactly, so we know it's exactly to the level of first order, and actually more orders, but for this talk, the first order matters. So like we know that this actually scales like the maximum clique size to logarithmic base 2n. So we know the constant, like to the extent that this little of 1 means that as n goes to infinity, this shrinks to 0. So we know exactly that there is a 2 log n. Okay, that's done. Now, if you are sort of more algorithmic-minded or a little bit more algorithmic-minded, the next sort of one of the next natural questions to ask is whether you can find such a clique of this size. And what do I mean by this? Of course, you can find such a clique of this size. You can really enumerate all the subgraphs of, let's say, cardinality 2 minus epsilon log 2n. And actually, you know, you can enumerate them and you can find this clique. But this will take you time n choose 2 minus epsilon log n, which, from a computer science point of view, it's considered too much, or potentially too much. It's non-polynomial in n, the time you will need to brute force find such a clique. So you can actually ask if there is an algorithm which is polynomial time, that is polynomial, which has termination time, which is polynomial in n, and actually find such a clique. So the best known to this day polynomial time algorithm in this sense, to find such a clique, actually is a greedy procedure. It's a very simple greedy procedure, like one of the best non-polynomial time algorithms. It's a greedy procedure. And finds a clique of size a half of the optimum. So 1 minus epsilon log n, it can be achieved by a very simple, yeah?
I'm sure you already told me that, but I forgot.
Yeah.
There are many such cliques, right?
Two minus epsilon again, yes. Yes. If epsilon is a fixed. But yes, the peak of the entropy is the one minus epsilon again. Yes. So you can find this, a half. But you can ask better. Of course, this is like something that people actually almost immediately realized. It's almost mentioned in one of these sort of seminal theoretical computer science papers by Karp, but many, many other people have realized that the greedy algorithm can do this. And they have asked the question, Karp in this 76 paper asked the question, and actually other people as well, whether you can beat this. To this day, we cannot. So to this day, this is like one of the most embarrassing sort of situations, like we cannot sort of find even 1 plus epsilon log n clique in a random graph.
So the most stupid algorithm is the best?
Yes, at the moment. Let's see. Well, like probabilities. So yes, so you know, people after 20 years from the 76, they start believing it's actually a hard problem, actually. Even before this, probably. That's definitely one indication, because they have created even cryptographic protocols, cryptographic primitives based on the hardness of finding 1 plus epsilon log n clique. So they really believe that it's actually a hard problem. And most importantly for us, for the planned clique model I'm going to describe, Jerrum had this actual result that sort of changed the picture, interestingly. By analyzing in 92, he analyzed the metropolis chain. So that's like a Markov chain on the space of cliques in random graphs. And basically, at his own words, this is what just one level of sophistication above the greedy algorithm. Just like, you know, one level of sophistication above. And ask whether this metropolis chain on the space of cliques, this Markov chain, can find something, can beat the greedy algorithm. And the answer is no. Like, he proves that you cannot. Like, it will stop at something of the order 1 minus epsilon log n. And then he made a crucial observation that actually this sort of changed, sort of created this planned clique model. So at least one way that this was created. So remember, like, this metropolis chain essentially sort of navigates in the space of cliques, but this doesn't matter at the moment. But like, essentially tries to find an 1 plus epsilon log n clique. What Jerrum observed is that his argument for negation of this, by the way, fail, I mean again, doesn't take polynomial time. That's why I mean fail. Like, it will find eventually the clique, but doesn't take polynomial time. He noticed that even if you artificially plant a large, much, much larger clique in this random graph, in the GN half, if you plant a clique of size k, which is k is like much larger than logarithmic scales, it's like almost square root n. N is the number of vertices. N to the half minus epsilon. Then actually his argument still works. That's essentially what he observed. Like this is not enough of an attractor, if you want, for large cliques, for the metropolis chain, which navigates in the space of cliques, to go to higher clique sizes than 1 plus epsilon. Okay. And you know, this is sort of, you know, surprising, I think, that like essentially this.
We're on the bad side here, but on the good side, if you have square root n, it works.
No idea. Like, he claims that it would be ridiculous if it's not, but he doesn't prove it. And to this day, we don't know this, actually. This question.
Well, do we have a threshold where we know?
Let me come at the end of the talk on this question. This is actually relevant to the geometry. Let me come.
You understand what I'm asking?
Of course.
In the analogy of the tensor PCA, yeah. We have.
Let me come to this. Yeah, that's actually, I will try, time permitted, I guess that I will reach this, to go to this exact point. Okay, so this created the planned clique model. Okay, if this decides to work. Yeah, so this created the planned clique model, which is like, initially people thought it would be a simpler question to analyze, like, but yet still surprisingly tough, which essentially says the following thing. Okay, forget about all this, 1 plus epsilon log n cliques. Let's say I have a GN half and I plant a clique of size k. Can I even detect the presence of such a clique? So what does it mean, detect the presence of such a clique? So it means that I have two words. One word that I have a GN half, and one word that I have a GN half and I plant a clique of size k. Like, can I hypothesis test essentially between the two words? And, you know, I care to do this both efficiently in polynomial time and both not. And more importantly to this talk, forget about the two words, focus on this model where you plant a clique. Can you actually recover this hidden clique? And for which k can you recover? So naturally, you know, Jerrum's result implies that no detection or recovery can be achieved by this metropolis chain, for example. Maybe, you know, they think it's a stretch, like how the failure of Markov chain created, like, you know, sort of the question, maybe just another sort of method can do it, and we will see. But actually, nothing can really beat.
I'm sorry to interrupt.
No.
What if the graph is sparser?
Yes.
then it should be easier to detect the pattern, right?
Yes.
The is P much smaller than constant.
Yeah, the thresholds, or much smaller than constant. So the thresholds change, but there is a similar behavior for not a clique, because clique is a very fully and too dense, but for a dense subgraph, denser subgraph. There are still computational statistical graphs, as we'll see in this, I think. Yeah, yeah. But not if you plan the clique, it's just too much. Like, yeah. In the sparse graph. Okay, so this is proper definition to make sure we understand what it is. So the planning clique model, independently introduced by Kuchera also 95 for different reasons. So G0, okay, how do you generate a sample from a G and half comma K? That's how I'm going to denote the planning clique model. So first you generate G0, which is an Erdős-Rényi, G and half. And then you choose K out of N. K is an input essentially of this, it's a parameter of the model. And you choose K out of the N vertices of G0, and uniformly at random, you just plant the clique among these vertices. And the question is, can you recover PC? I could call PC the planning clique for obvious reasons. And can you recover PC from observing an instance of the G and half comma K? And you know, the question is, for how small k can you actually recover, both if you have all the time in the world and both if you restrict yourself to polynomial time. And here is like a very small graphical representation. You know, you have like 7 vertices, you sample at G7 comma half, and you flip a coin independently and you get the graph. And then you choose 3 of them at random, and it happens to be 3 vertices, and you push this to be a triangle, and you erase the colors, and you ask, can you recover the triangle? Make sense, the model? Okay, so let's see what's happening. So this has actually a vast literature, but I will just give you an idea where we are. So first of all, there is this notion of statistical limit, which says you have all the time in the world. When can you actually spot this clique? When can you recover this clique? And this is an easy question. This is an easy random graph theory question. So the moment you have 2 plus epsilon log n, a little bit bigger than the maximum clique of just an Erdős-Rényi random graph, actually it's a unique clique. Like, it doesn't create any other cliques of this size, and it's sort of obvious, and you can sort of recover it by brute force checking. And if it's 2 minus epsilon log n, essentially get lost in the bulk of all these cliques, and you can recover. So that's an easy sort of question, and you can persuade easily yourself if you haven't done this exercise that this is the case. On the other hand, you need to go all the way to this square.
Is this a coincidence that this is the same size as the...
No.
It's
exactly the same arguments, I'm sort of. Like, somehow, like, if it's 2 minus epsilon again, just because of the noise, there are other patterns like this, and it's just, you cannot distinguish. Like, you cannot understand which one was planted or not. And if it's 2 plus epsilon again, it requires a little bit of a computation, but it just doesn't create this pattern again. Yeah. And, you know, interestingly, you need to go all the way to square root 10 to have actually polynomial time results. So there is this actually quite important work when it appeared by Alon, Krivel, Levis, and Sudakov, that actually if you have now a size square root 10 clique, so constant square root 10, then actually there is a spectral method with a little bit of a boosting at the end that can actually recover the planning clique. So any constant square root 10 is good enough. And also similar, like AMP analysis and other sort of results have proven that this clique size is actually spotable by polynomial time. Yet, you know, a picture I like to put when I give such talks is that, you know, there is like a mind the gap type of thing. So it's like it's a big gap here, like between what we know that we should be doing is logarithmic versus the square root 10, what we just can do in polynomial time. And you can ask, you know, whether like something has been proven in this regime, mm-hmm. And a lot of things have been proven in this regime.
So the spectral method here is
you take the adjacent matrix,
and the top eigenvalue.
You take the second eigenvalue because it has bias, and you just keep the k first, and you do. There is a little bit of a processing step after, but like that's essentially the argument. Yeah.
So it's not sharp in the sense that it works for every c.
Yes, and that's the boosting that I'm saying before, and somehow there is a way to push it for every c. But you're right. Yes. The semicircle law some sort of gives the another. So, yeah.
Okay, so I think my question was related. So for any fixed C positive, you can recover the entire clique.
The entire clique.
But you cannot let C go to zero extremely slowly.
With N?
Yeah.
Yes, we cannot. Yeah, you're right. It's a...
Like, there's no...
I mean, it's just...
It's an abstract function. Like, it's not possible to say there exists a C N going to zero. So
Not really, because essentially the running time of these algorithms will depend in a way, let's say, n to the 1 over c, something like this, which, you know, the running time will just become super polynomial the moment you sort of... It doesn't scale exactly like 1 over c, don't take this, but like, yeah, you get whatever. Yeah. Okay, so you can ask what results have been proven here. So, you know, we discussed Jerrum result has been proven to fail, like this Markov chain has proven to fail in this regime. There is this, you know, I'm passing this very fast, but that's actually quite important results. Like in sum of squares hierarchy, which is like a family of very powerful, considerably very powerful theoretical computer science methods, semi-definite programs essentially, like that's what they are, like have been proven actually to fail also in this regime if you have like a small, like it's not n square root n, but like n to the half minus 1 over log n, something like that. Like a very tiny sort of gap here, but essentially they fail. A family of statistical query methods also like, well, like people in statistics, like they believe they're very powerful, also have proven to fail in some appropriate, let's say, assumptions. And you know, you can ask, okay, is this like a particularity of the Planck clique model? I mean, some people in the audience know it very well. It is not. So this is not like a special picture. This is actually a classical picture. So this is called computational statistical gap. It has a name. That like is it's a gap between what we should be able to be doing in these recovery problems and what we seem to be doing. And you know, a lot of statistical models like regression, sparse regression, PCA models, community detection models, we see this behavior that we cannot explain, but we have a name for, which is like the computational statistical gap. And interestingly though, Planck clique is not just another computational statistical gap. So it starts to be believed in the community that actually has a very special role. And this started with this sort of important work by Berthier and Goliath 2013, and it continues to this day by the group of Guy Bressler at MIT, that essentially Planck clique plays a core role among all these computational statistical gaps to the extent of a computational theory reduction, so complexity theory reduction. Like, it has been proven that if, for many of these models that we know that there are gaps, you can penetrate into the hard region, then you can easily, not easily, there is a polynomial time procedure to penetrate the Planck clique gap. So these gaps are starting to be related, and I think it's quite fascinating.
But this I don't get now, because in the tensor PCA case, precisely the SOS penetrates.
You're right. Okay. So tensor PCA has nothing.
Yeah, the gap here was for spectral ONP is...
You're right. So
the SOS is smaller.
Yes, so I don't know exactly what has been in the tensor PCA, but for example, in the sparse PCA, like what they consider, I think the computational statistical gap in sparse PCA is also the performance of SOS and everything. So it's more shrink, the gap. And for this gap, I think they have reductions. So if you are able to beat the SOS also, then you can penetrate. But you are right. Okay, so what I'm going to say about this in this talk. So I will try to offer a more geometric perspective on understanding this. So I will try to tell you a result that tries to understand the square root 10 here threshold, similar to this that has a very specific meaning, right? That's exactly the statistical threshold. That's a threshold we can actually spot the clique if we had all the, just a statistical estimator procedure. Here I will try to tell you a result that this square root 10 actually is also plays, give you evidence, actually, not a complete proof, and partial results, that this square root 10 is actually a phase transition point for the landscape of the model, and specifically for the presence of a certain overlap gap property, as we say, that I will properly define, in the space of dense subgraphs of the GN half comma k. So like give you an interpretation of like evidence for interpretation of this square root 10 as not just an arbitrary point where algorithms fail, but there is a geometric meaning to the thing. And you know, OGP, which is interesting, is that like originates in spin-glass theory analysis, like at least its notion and its inspiration, and is known there to suggest algorithmic hardness when it appears. So it sort of coincides our understanding between very different worlds, essentially. Okay, so how am I going to structure this? So I will try to first of all tell you a little bit about the overlap property in some generality, because like that's a notion, I don't know how much familiar you are with it. So I'll sort of tell you what is this overlap property, and you what more specifically the overlap property for recovery problems, which is like much less known also. Then I will move to the Planck clique and give you the exact definition. Then I will describe you a tool of essentially that could be of independent interest from a random graph theory point of view, like how I understand the densest subgraph problem in the Erdős-Rényi case. So if you don't care about statistics and algorithms, maybe you can take something from this point. And finally, tell you essentially this evidence that I'm saying, that there is like this square root n phase transition. And then we'll conclude. OK, so what is this thing? OK, so I discussed about computational statistical gaps. But actually, computational gaps or computational bottlenecks are actually quite frequent. Their appearance are quite frequent in random environments. So in many cases, like especially, for example, optimization in random environments, this is like very common. That like, for example, in optimization of spin classes, where the inspiration is coming from, in many cases, we see that like if you try to optimize a random function, let's say over some space or over the sphere, like we see that the actual optimum is far above what we seem to be able to do with, let's say, local methods or like the classic sort of algorithms that we can use, with, of course, distinct counterexamples to this. But like that's sort of the picture. It's like a classic picture that there are gaps in what one do. And also, we just saw it in discrete settings, right? In the maximum clique in a random graph, I was describing you that we have a gap between 2 log n and log n with what we can do or not. And here, even in sparse Erdős-Rényi graphs, in the maximum independent set, has been also a lot of work understanding this computational gap. Also, a distinct example from a different sort of community in the TCS community is the random k-sat model, the random satisfiability model, which have been the last decade quite a thing. And like again, there is a big and distinct computational gap between what we just by brute force methods can do and what by polynomial time methods can do. All of them are non-explainable by complexity theory considerations. So how we have a question mark in the community of why this thing exists. And what is this geometric perspective that has been applied to all three, actually, and the inspiration is coming from spin classes, is that between the regime that we have algorithms and between the regime that we don't have algorithms, yet we know that we should, if we had all the time in the world, achieve, there is a very different geometry. So there is a very different geometry in the solution space of this optimization problem, say, between the regime that we have, the easy and the hard regime, as we say. And specifically, the geometry usually concerns the near-optimal solutions. So like you focus on the near-optimal solutions, and you see the geometry, and it's sort of easy to see a phase transition in this geometry between the regimes. And we don't. And actually, you know, this is, I'm borrowing this line from this random case at the essential paper by Akliopoulos and Kozaklan. And, you know, because I think it nicely phrases what happens. And you know, this has been sort of reverse engineered, and people for a new problem just study directly the geometry, like this has been, and they claim, okay, this is possibly a computational hard regime starting from this point. Okay, how do they study the geometry? So different ways. And you know, I'm only going to describe one here. And I will describe it vaguely in two. And then I will make this recurse. So one vague strategy of studying the geometry is as follows. In optimization always. So you take the near-optimal solutions, and there is a notion of overlap. So you imagine if it's points vectors on the sphere, essentially you take the angles between them. And you study the realizable overlaps between them, the realizable angles between near-optimal solutions. Like how much, if I take all the possible near-optimal solutions, how much do they overlap? And then the wisdom, essentially, that comes from this line of work is that algorithms appear to work, polynomial time algorithms appear to exist, as long as there is no prohibited such algorithms, as long as there are no gaps in these overlap sizes. And you know, just to understand, like what I mean by this is that if you have two near-optimal solutions at specific angle, all the angles in between should be realizable by some near-optimal solution. And this is coming from a local search point of view, that if you navigate into this space, and you are like far away, let's say, and essentially you have like these bottlenecks that this gaps in these specific angles, essentially, you know, this creates a lot of bottlenecks for the actual algorithms to go away. And like that's sort of the inspiration. But of course, this is like just a statement for a property. You know, what I'm describing here is called overlap gap property, or at least that's a natural name for it. There are other names and similar properties, not identical, not equivalent, importantly, in this thing. So for example, there is shattering property, clustering property, condensation phase transition, free energy wells in spin class theory, and the more involved full replica symmetry breaking, which sort of relates to this notion. But this is like a simple sort of notion that you can sort of parse just independently if you want.
Overlap gap means the contrary of full replica symmetry.
Not really. Like if you have like a continuous interval for the overlaps.
Yeah, I understand. But, yeah. But if you have KRSB, you necessarily have overlap gap.
Oh, yeah. No, absence of overlap gap property is full replication. You're right, yeah, of course. or replica symmetry. Yeah, you're right. If you want to translate it in this setting. Yes, exactly. Okay, so that's what happens in optimization. Now I'm talking about statistics, a statistical recovery problem. So that's sort of a different picture. So how do you actually define the OGP for recovery problems? Okay, so I'm just stating like a very trivial thing here. So in statistics, like in parametric statistics, what happens is you have an X which comes from a distribution that depends on some parameter theta. Here it's theta star. SSL, you can say that belongs to the parameter space, and because we care about geometry, we assume this is a subset of a Hilbert space, and something we can find norms, and let's say that the norm is one of this hidden parameter. And what I mean by this is you observe X and you want to recover theta star. In this setting, you observe the graph and you want to recover PC. Right? It's sort of exactly sort of the same picture. It's a recovery problem. Okay, how to define overlapping property for this? It's not actually an optimization problem. So optimization problem is not immediately there, yet the way that people usually recover this theta star is via optimization. So that's sort of like the actual sort of connection. That the way that actually people recover this optimization, whatever this call like maximum likelihood or empirical risk minimization, it's usually by choosing some loss function. Choosing some loss function L, calligraphic L, let's say, which is actually informative, and I will explain what I mean by this. And they try to minimize this loss function over the space of parameters. Okay, that's usually what people try to do to recover the theta star. And what is the loss function? This loss function is defined on the data you see, on the parameter you guess to be theta star. And then, okay, by abusing notation, I condition on theta star just to tell you that you remember that X is a random, essentially it's a random function, that X depends on theta star. But theta star is not the input of the function. Okay, so this is like the loss function. It depends on X and theta. And you want to minimize this thing. And what does informative mean? It means that at the very least, if you manage to minimize it, you should recover theta star. So like it should be like informative to the extent if I carry this optimization, it's relevant for the statistical task. Like you should recover this. And if you have this, actually, you can define OGP. Like OGP for this would be take near optimal solutions in principle and see how much the near optimal thetas actually overlap between each other. That's a natural thing. Though there is a catch. Like, usually, the quantity that matters here is not just the mutual dot product, but because you really care to go to the minimum, not to near optimize it, you want the dot product with the theta star itself. That's like the direction that really matters to you. Like, the gaps will matter only if they are in the direction towards the theta star. Like, bottlenecks in the landscape, in principle, could matter. But the principal thing that matters is how hard is it to navigate towards theta star. So, like, because you care to go actually to the minimum here, right? You don't care to navigate generally into the space and go to a near optimal solution. This will not be good enough. You really want to sort of slide down all the way to theta star. And, the OGP informally would be that the thetas, according to this loss function for this recovery problem, the theta that make the small function small enough will have the overlap gap property if the thetas that minimize approximately the loss will happen even in the one case where theta is very aligned with theta star, which makes sense, or if they are semi-orthogonal to theta star. So like essentially it just happened to be in the bulk and out of the noise, they just minimize the loss. And that's all. Essentially like there are prohibited overlaps for minimizing sufficiently or like approximately minimizing the loss. And that's sort of the phenomenon that like we call like a bottleneck for the recovery problem. Okay, this could be like a little bit like difficult to parse, but hopefully it will be like more clear actually if I give you this interpretation. Yeah?
Is this really different from saying that if I take two, you insisted that this is with respect to theta star, but if I say any two near minimizers, it's not obvious to me that these are different statements.
So one is stronger, I mean, clear, like in principle. Yeah, in principle, yes. And then it's not obvious, and I don't have a proof that actually they are different.
But there are cases where it's clear. Again, thanks to PCA. This function is the latitude, theta star is the north pole, and so you may have plenty around the equator, right? And then here, whether you have or not, OGP is different from the fact that you.
But if I ask all minimizers, I will also have a gap between.
Essentially, the idea is that like you could have gaps, like for thetas that are sort of irrelevant with theta star, but somehow you don't care about them. Like if you escape from them, you really want to slide to theta star. That's like sort of the maybe okay. And this picture is actually maybe giving you some indication more. So define the following function. Okay, fix the possible overlap zeta. Okay, fix the angle that you want with theta star. And define the gamma of zeta to be the minimum loss that can be achieved by a theta that has this specific overlap with theta star. Okay, so define exactly this function, like the minimum loss that can be achieved by this zeta. If zeta is 1, this is only one of them here. Certainly by cos is 1's inequality, this is only theta star. So you know that this is actually the global minimum, just by because it's informative. If zeta equals 0, this is like, or like near 0, or whatever, like essentially this sort of higher entropy on theta is, like, but think of it as zero for the moment, then like essentially, you know, this is the loss that you don't care. Essentially, you know, this can happen just because it's orthogonal, but like this is like a real recovery problem that doesn't, shouldn't care for this kind of loss. And essentially you can see that actually if this, if you plot this function, of course the minimum is attained at zeta equal one, that's what it should, for being informative. And then the question is, how does it decrease essentially to one? Decrease, how does it go? To the zeta equal one, how does it behave? And you know, naturally you can say maybe it's decreasing. Okay, so maybe, you know, the more you overlap, the smaller the loss, and that will be like sort of a good indication of geometry. But then usually OGP is actually, and it is equivalent in this sense with having non-monotonicity of this function gamma. So like initially you have to climb a hill. Like initially if you go to higher overlap, the loss becomes suddenly worse. Like, you don't have a gradient if you want to go towards the higher overlap size in the beginning until you reach a hill point, and then you just, like, smoothly can decrease. And, you know, this actually provably relates to the performance of at least low-temperature MCMC methods and local methods. Like, such creates actually a bottleneck for worse initialization MCMC methods. But to see why such a behavior applies to OGP, you can see it here. So here, again, this axis is like the overlap. And this axis is the loss, the training error, as we say. And assume that the function looks like this, okay? And assume I put this red line here. This red line denotes the loss that I will consider for this and below. So give me all the thetas that have loss function at most this red line. And then I can ask which thetas that have overlap zeta actually can achieve such a loss. If you are here with low overlap, the function is below this red. So the best among them for each such overlap can beat this loss. So this is like a feasible region for my task. Like there are overlaps, thetas with this overlap that can beat this loss. Similarly here, if the overlap is high enough, the function is beating this threshold, so this is feasible, this is realizable. And here there are gaps, because the function, the best among them cannot beat this loss function. All of them have loss at least this red here. Essentially, you project down to this and you see the disconnectivity. And this disconnectivity is what we call overlap gap property. Okay, so that's a sort of geometric. Okay, and you can ask, you know, how successful this method is. Like, okay, I described you this, you know, I made a lot of jumps here, right? I mean, I told you about optimization, and I told you about statistics, and I say I will choose this loss function, and like, okay. And then I can ask, I forgot to say, of course, the question is, does this actually appear in the landscape, or if I'm saying, am I saying nonsense about what actually happens? And, you know, this is like, you know, this is, you know, it's hard to give sort of a literature on this, but like this is actually sort of is appearing, and some sort of success stories as in sparse linear regression with David at 2017 in the middle of my PhD, we proved that actually this phenomenon I'm describing, the transition between this curve looking like this and looking decreasing, is actually exactly coincides with the phase transition of the computational limit. So somehow, like, there is really like a success in the landscape and what we know computationally in the sparse linear regression case. And similar results have been established in sparse PCA, but some people actually that were here in Courant, like David, of course, and Nokus, who is a student of Gerard, and some recent results we have with Gerard and Alex, and Alex Wine, who is an instructor also at Courant, and Tessor PCA, Gerard, Reza, who is a PhD student here also, and Nokus. Like, they prove that OGP holds at least in a part of the computational statistical gap regime. So this is actually a more non-rigorous statement, and also not predicting that this is actually the picture. So, like, there is sort of a success story going on about this sort of interpretation for recovery models. And, you know, as I told you, planned clique has a distinct sort of importance among the computational statistical gaps, so we consider natural, like with David, to go and investigate this. Okay, so planet clique. I stop this sort of general theme lighting and I will dive into the planet clique mode. Okay, so recall, G is a G and half comma K. That means I have a G and half and artificially plant a clique of size K. And I ask whether I can recover the planet clique. Okay, I want to define novel lambda property for this. So I need to define optimization problems that I will study the landscape of them. So this will be slightly complicated, but not terribly complicated. So I will first tune a parameter k bar. You will see the importance of it later on. So there will be this parameter k bar, which between the vertex size of the clique and the vertex size of the graph. So the importance of it will hopefully become later clear. So I will analyze some optimization problems. Okay. So the optimization problems, the solution space will be, I will consider all the subgraphs of size k bar. Okay, so I will consider all the subgraphs of size of vertex size, excuse me about this, all the subgraphs of vertex size k bar. Okay, so this will be like the space that I will try to orient myself. And then I need to define a loss function. Okay, how am I going to navigate? The goal is again to find somehow the clique, to spot the clique, if you navigate in the space of k bar subgraphs. So the loss function I'm going to describe associated with C, this, let's say, a specific k bar subgraph, is essentially the distance to be a clique. Okay, so how far it is from being a clique. So this is essentially k bar choose 2 minus the number of induced edges that you see in this app. Okay, so why this makes sense? Okay, so if k bar is equal to k, then, which is a natural thing, then this is minimized exactly at the planet clique. It's a unique clique, and the minimum is this. You can imagine if k bar is a little bit higher than k, then that this would still be the case. And the reason for this is because there's a huge gap between the k clique and the next clique. Like, there's a huge gap for this. And why do you want to lift k bar? Like, the reason is a sort of classical optimization perspective, that somehow if you lift a little bit the space, some natural geometric barriers actually erase themselves. Somehow to avoid some trivialities and geometric barriers, which we will see that they actually appear if you just stick with k bar equal k. This is a mystery a little bit yet to be understood completely, but we see this phenomenon. Okay. Important thing, this is a constant term. So equivalently, this looks like this. So that tells you, take all the subgraphs of k bar size and tell me the densest one. That's what the name is usually. Like, what has the largest edge density? And this has a name, it's called actually k bar densest subgraph problem because you fix the vertex size, but I will simply call it densest subgraph. Okay, so what will be the overlap gap for this optimization problem? Oh, and just one thing that I wanted to mention. Like, one natural thing to consider here would be the posterior. So, like, you can, you know, the natural thing somebody can say is instead of doing all this thing about close to a clique, you can say, well, what's the probability that C is actually the clique? That's a natural MLE procedure. This actually doesn't work. Like, it creates a trivial geometry, which is because the posterior is actually a Dirac sort of distribution at the planet clique and has no geometry and you cannot really define an interesting sort of picture. So, that's why you go to this surrogate, which is actually the likelihood of a similar problem where you plant a dense subgraph here, but with probability between the edges that actually are arbitrarily close to one. So somehow it's like an approximation, if you want, to the actual likelihood. Okay, so what will be the overlap gap here? So the natural overlap of a C is like how much do you overlap with the planet clique? Like, you are dense, good, but like, are you dense because you overlap with the planet clique? Or are you dense, you know, because you're just not overlapping with the planet clique, just have many of them. So the overlap gap property with this, of course, there's one question, you know, even if you completely overlap with the clique, because k bar is larger than k, that is not clear how you actually recover the clique from this point on, but there's sort of a standard pushing procedure if k bar is not much, much larger. Okay, so k bar OGB would mean the following thing. Then that's just a random graph question. When does dense subgraphs, dense enough subgraphs of g and half comma k, have the property that they are large simply because they overlap with the clique a lot, or they overlap with the clique a little bit? Like when there is this description, and that will be like the computational bottleneck, the conjecture.
So this is like your latitude.
That's my latitude, exactly. Like the, how much do you overlap with the clique? And you know, that's a proper definition. I don't want to spend time on this. Just to tell you, you know, you need a little bit like to think how to properly define this. You need to find these thresholds for what does it mean to overlap a little and to overlap a lot, and a threshold for what does it mean to be dense enough. And if there are these thresholds, and there is this distinction, to be dense enough means you are either overlapping a little and or overlap a lot, and of course it's non-vacuous, like there is a low overlap dense subgraph and a high overlap dense subgraph, then we say overlapping property takes place. Okay, so to analyze this, the first step, as it's usual the case, you better be able to analyze it in the case where there is no plan P. Okay, so you better understand like what happens in this dense subgraph problem if there is no plan P. And you know, if you actually do this, we were sort of certain actually at this point that like we could just find another sort of clique number type of argument that like, you know, it's just we know it perfect. But actually we don't. Like the dense subgraph problem in random graph theory, to the best of our knowledge, is actually not understood. Like what is exactly the concentration properties of this process, of this like maximization position. And we search for it, and actually the best result is actually 2018 result.
But if you make the analogy with the
Gaussian,
this would be the spin glass problem.
Exactly.
And so this is your Hamiltonian.
That's exactly my Hamiltonian.
So this is a zero temperature thing.
That's exactly zero
temperature. But would there be a Gibbs measure, a natural study of Gibbs measure for these things?
It would be. That's like a sparse setting.
So is it, yeah, so the natural question is this spin glass model 1 RSB at the temperature?
So it's complicated. So it's not clear, like when K is of order N, then actually some reason out of focus and co-authors actually can understand how this behaves. I don't know if they understand the 1 RSB, for example, or something like this, but they understand the limited constant which relates with Parisi, so temperature. But if K is much smaller than N, I don't think any of these techniques is like applying immediately. So we're in a really sort of sparse case with the planet.
You're interested in K much smaller.
Yes, like at square root N, let's say. Okay, so the best result, to the best of my knowledge, is the result by the group of Bolobas and co-authors at 2018, where they have understood the case when k is logarithmic. So when k is constant logarithmic, okay, if k is less than 2 log n, there is a clique of this size. So that's sort of an easy thing. It's like the answer is k choose 2. Right? There's a fully connected subgraph of this size. If k is bigger than log n, constant log n bigger than 2, actually they do the first and second moment method, so that's the first moment method estimate. Quite challenging, not trivial, and to go to this. And they were able to get exact sort of characterization, actually they proven stronger two-point concentration for this behavior, which is actually quite nice, but still doesn't really apply to us. Like we want to go to polynomial sizes to say something. Okay, and here is this comes from the lab deviation theory of the binomial. It's natural to consider this binary entropy. Okay, so what we do is we took the technique, and you know, that's possibly of independent interest, and we push it to the polynomial sizes. So we push it to the polynomial sizes, and we saw that actually this k-dense subgraph in the Erdős-Rényi case, pure Erdős-Rényi case, actually this prediction for the first moment is actually still correct if you know you go to polynomial sum sizes up to a higher order error term. And you know, there's of course some comparison whether this is actually relevant. Did you just kill all this thing with this error term? Actually not. We saw that like the first two order terms survive. So like the first we understand this to the first two orders. Exactly all the way up to square root n. And you know, just to a little bit understand this, you know, this is like the expected value of each one of them. Like if you fix a subgraph here, you know, it's a binomial k bar choose 2 comma half. This is like the expected value, like, sorry, it's not k bar here, it's k square over 4. And essentially this is essentially Gaussian fluctuations, if you want, in the thing, but we saw it's actually tight, even beside the correlation of the fact that it's binomial, and then we have lower order terms. I will go away from this, but I think, you know, improvement on this is possible, and it's quite fundamental for the conjecture I'm going to say at the end, like of how to improve this. And, you know, just a very quick thing, actually, I'm running, yeah, I guess we started a little bit late, so I guess I should be okay. But, like, I just want to tell you a little bit about this proof, like, you know, if you, it's again first and second moment method, but if you do vanilla second moment method, it just doesn't work. Like it just explodes. Like what do I mean by this? You count the counting random variable of the dense subgraphs. Like if you see the first moment and you wish that the square of it is like the second moment, this is just not true. So what you do is you use L condition, and that's a classic sort of trick. You condition on this, and we use a flattened version of the second moment method, inspired by the work of course of Bolobas and Kolos of 2018. But like it requires a lot of fine tuning as well. And we saw existence of a sufficiently dense as we want, but also flat subgraph. So like we condition this to be flat. And what do we mean by flat? Well, it's a little bit of a complicated notion, but I don't want you to pass all this. Just want to tell you that a graph is flat if it has the density you want, and also there is no peaky subgraphs of this subgraph. So somehow there is not subgraph here that's extremely dense just by chance. And why this is relevant is because if you compute the second moment, like, you need to understand how these dense subgraphs overlap between each other. So if they overlap in a very weird sort of way, if there's like a peaky dense subgraph, it kills, essentially blows the second moment. So how, like, we need to fine tune. It's like a little bit like a, you need really like to take care and to tame this, but it actually works.
Yeah, so it's really like a modified second moment where you know what the bad event is.
Exactly.
And you get rid of it.
Exactly. It takes, the bad thing is that there's not like a really unifying art of how to find it. So you need sort of to, yeah. Okay, so actually, let me now tell you with this tool, what are the OGP things. Okay, so I need to define the curve. Okay, so maybe it's a good time to remind you, actually, like, what are we doing, right? So, like, this is the, this is 2 log n, and this is square root n. And the question is if this is, you know, this is hard, and whether OGP actually appears in this regime. And there's the phase transition. So, okay, so we define this following curve, right? And yeah, maybe let me remind you all this. Like the curve that is actually, okay, so the curve, right? So you define this curve and we expect that this thing means OGP for the curve. Like the higher the overlap, at the end it works, but it takes a hill to work. If it's just decreasing, we expect no OGP and that's actually a music regime. And there is, you know, sort of a third case that somebody needs to consider, which is what if it looks like this? Like, if you go towards the overlap, you just continuously, like, have higher and higher loss. That's completely non-informative. That's a very bad landscape. Like, it means nothing for the recovery purposes. This is the best case, and this is, like, the overlap gap property sort of case. Okay, so what we do is we define this curve, and, you know, we do the first moment bound first. Okay, so do the first moment bound, similar to the Erdős-Rényi case. So this is decomposes nicely. This is the loss you pay by overlapping Z with the clique. So you fix Z, the overlap of the clique. I forgot to say this. And you say, what's the minimum loss achieved by having exactly Z vertices in common with the planar clique? And you know, this decomposes nicely. There is a deterministic lower bound, which is having Z, the loss you pay by overlapping Z. And this is like the Erdős-Rényi structure here. The loss you will pay by because exactly of this Erdős-Rényi structure on this part of your curve. And, you know, before diving into, we saw how hard the second moment was for the Erdős-Rényi case, we said, okay, can we actually analyze this? You know, it has the inverse of a binary entropy case, but still a deterministic function. We should be able to understand, like, how does this behave? And is this like this? Yeah, I have these notions there. And this is, like, actually, I think, the evidence for the conjecture. So let's see how this behaves. It has a very particular structure. So if k is much smaller than square root n, so we're in the potentially hard regime, right? So that's k. Then, if k bar is close to k, but at most k square, so like if you lift, but you lift not terribly, so k square is less than n because k is much smaller than square root n, then it's actually OGP behavior. Gamma bar is non-monotonic, and it has the right sort of thing. It's non-monotonic, and that's a conjecture I have here in parentheses, a low temperature MCMC. If you lift a lot, it becomes increasing. You are like in this terribly bad thing that you have nothing to do with the signal. Okay, so two cases for square root n. If you lift a little bit, you have barriers. If you lift a lot, you just lose the signal. On the other hand, if you are much bigger than square root n, then if you lift a little bit, you still have bottlenecks. Even if it is an OGP behavior, that's why I told you cannot take k bar equal to k immediately. If you lift a little bit, you still have bottlenecks. Like, you still see this non-monotonicity. But if you lift a lot, it's actually become decreasing. Not only you erase the bottlenecks, but it's informative what's happening. And this is sort of the phase transition that we conjecture.
So you want to choose the second thing.
Exactly. That's the thing. You want to lift, actually. And the question is, when does this compare with n? Like, because like some of these regimes are actually trivial. One of these regimes is actually trivial in some regimes of k. Like, you are always in this lifted procedure. If this, because k bar is at least k, like sometimes this is like just trivially. And I like this sort of phase diagram to give you an indication of what happens. So if this is k and this is k bar, and that's a conjecture again, OGP. So we focus above the diagonal. And if k is smaller than square root n, there is this k bar equal k square here transition. that below we know that we have OGP, and we consider it hard. But if you lift a lot, there is no OGP, but it's uninformative. And on the other hand, if k is at least square root n, we know that there is OGP below this n square over k square curve. But if you lift more, it's on OGP and it's actually informative. And that's sort of the phase transition that we conjecture.
So when you say conjecture?
We do first moment calculation.
Just the first moment.
Yes. Which is, I mean, by itself is not like a sort of easy sort of task, but yeah. And you know, there is one interesting indication here, right? What if you choose k bar equal k? Like, you didn't do this trick. And actually, that's what we didn't do, of course, in the beginning. Like, and we're sort of thinking about writing a paper only with k bar equal k. It's a very bizarre phenomenon. What happens if you project down here? You have OGP until this point, and OGP stops after this point, which gives you a phase transition at n to the 2/3, which is like has no meaning algorithmically. And you know, that means that MCMC methods possibly will fail at all the way if they navigate in the space of k subgraphs, which is a natural thing, will fail all the way up to the n to 2/3. But if you lift, you get this sort of potentially beautiful structure, essentially, and you see actually the square root n importance in this thing. So essentially, you're missing the picture if you don't lift, which is a potentially interesting thing. And you know, you can ask, okay, how much of this is actually rigorous at the moment? I would say little. So little, there is. Actually, if you see the paper, you will say, okay, a lot of work has actually been rigorous. No, there's a lot of work for a little of this being rigorous at the moment. So we are able to prove the presence of OGP for a big part of the gap, but still much smaller than square root n. So we are able to go all the way to a small constant alpha here and prove that OGP exists here. Yet we cannot prove this, I think, very nice phase transition type of thing at the moment. So what we are able to do is we're able to prove that if k and k bar is at most n to the alpha, where alpha is like a small constant, like 0.1, I don't believe this is fundamental. I believe this is technical. And if k bar is as predicted, not terribly large, because otherwise we expect that it is not, it's just increasing, because we are the below square root n regime, in the hard regime, that actually the curve looks like this. Then that's a proper sort of statement. And also, as a corollary, MCMC methods with low temperature actually fail in this regime. But the interesting thing is that we predict this all the way up to the n to the 2/3. Like if you focus k bar equal k, otherwise.
So this said that it's hard for this algorithm.
Yeah.
But
yeah. Yeah.
They could come into something else.
You mean for the MCMC methods?
Yeah.
Yeah, of course, of course. I mean, it's just a geometric bottleneck that can literally prove the MCMC methods. We have these recent works that also AMP, though, like by David and Okus, that like essentially seem to be prohibited by this regime for spin classes, though. The conjecture is that this is potentially fundamental, but, you know, like we have counterexamples also. So it's like, I mean, there is a lot of care to be done. Even at this simple problem, the fact that you need to lift is like, what does it really mean, right? I mean, it's to see like some square root n. Okay, let me conclude. So what I told you is essentially this, that there is evidence that OGP holds or is uninformative below the square root n regime. There is evidence that if you are above square root n, it's either OGP holds or there is sufficiently a good choice of lift that we can quantify, that you erase OGP and you're still informative. And what we have proven is essentially that here, up to n to the 0.1, which is, you know, an exponential, like compared to log n, essentially presence, actually there is OGP. So like, but still there is, you know, a long way to go. And you know, some open sort of questions that arise in this work. I mean, it's not hard to see what's the first one. Like, we have a conjecture here that, like, that's actually the shape. And that is, I think, this very nice thing. It's very important, the square root n important, the square root n, yeah, with the square root n transition. Like, in the planned clique model, I mean, it has led to cryptographic things. In statistics, it has this complexity theory reductions. I think it's, like, a worth and very sort of nice also mathematical structure hiding behind. To be proven, it will require a lot of techniques, and one of these techniques is just independent of anything, which is like just the g and half case. So in the g and half case, you know, we were able to prove this behavior for k at most square root n, like the first two leading terms. To prove the phenomenon I'm describing, you really need to understand this. And you really need to understand, I mean, essentially show that this little o of k, like that will be the crucial thing. If somebody can show that, like, essentially this is not k to the 3, it's not only that you can beat this thing, but you can actually understand this. And you know, the second order term is like, again, requires a lot of effort to be able to understand this. You know, essentially, if k is of order n, for example, this is like the Parisi sort of related formula here, like you really need to, though, to go to lower order terms. It's like a phenomena that happen at very small scales, these behaviors, like to sort of quantify them exactly. And but I think it's sort of a very nice math problem and for the subset of Erdős-Rényi graphs. And finally, you know, there is this lifting thing, like that I think it's sort of interesting to understand. Like, you know, is it like fundamental in any way? There is some mathematical reason to lift that I didn't describe at the interest of time that I can happily discuss after, why you need to lift. And you can see sort of in the local search analysis of a local search algorithm why you need to lift. But we see also in sparse PCA in this work by actually people again from Courant, like Yunzi Ding and team, like which are like PhD students, Alex and Afonso that used to be at Courant, and this recent work by Gerard, Alex and myself, like we still lift in some way, or we actually misparameterize the sparsity parameter now in PCA to get a lot of results. In other models where we have a lot of rich behavioral attention on PCA, I'm not sure what does this would correspond to. So that's sort of, if you are interested in this, I have a question. Yeah, and I would think I will stop here.
So the, yeah, this lifting in abstract nonsense would be really nice to understand.
Yeah.
But in your curve, it goes up to n, right? The k bar. At the
yes, I mean there is
the curve, the one. That
Yeah. We know we want little of n, but up to n exactly.
So, but then it means you're looking at the densest subgraph for very very large graph.
Yes, but little of n, like somehow you cannot touch proportional regime. But small constant, yes. Yes, possibly you can. Yes. So, and still, yes. Yeah, I mean, I don't know exactly what you're asking, but somehow, if it's n over 2, then it starts becoming a little bit too much.
That's what
yes.
It looks like this.
That's, you lost the signal completely, possibly, at this stage. But still, if you are in this regime and you go to, like small constant n, it's still a good algorithmic regime. There is drift to go to there. Yes, I mean, it's a... Yeah, I mean, even an analysis, a provable analysis, that local search method. So I think I have a result that, like, that you know, I should write down, but like somehow that local search method essentially will work in this regime with some boosting at the end. But it's not like that convincing. We would like all the way to have a result with local search methods, but it's actually a nice probability sort of, I think, question of how to prove all the way that it works. Yeah, I mean, yeah.
Because, you know, there. It may have nothing to do with this, but intensive PCA, one nice trick, which is the thing done by Giulio and Chiara, Giulio Biroli, Chiara Caramarotta, where they do replicated dynamics.
Yeah.
And they do many of them, and then
maybe.
It looks like a lifting, because they also need to have many of those replicated dynamics to begin to precisely, once you escape the equator, to...
You're right, I could imagine K bar, you say, being like just essentially K subgraphs running around.
Yes.
It should be. It could be.
So it might be that the lifting intensive PCA is very close to the replicated.
Could be. Exactly. Like the idea of the K bar is really that somehow a typical K bar subgraph, if you just randomly choose a K bar subgraph, by chance you will intersect the clique a lot, which will not happen when K bar equal K, and then you get signal. So somehow it starts having a drift, the random k bar subgraph. But somehow, if it's k, then you miss the signal. But
this is exactly what they do, the replicated thing. When they
so that the one catches the one.
It increases the drift.
You're right. No, I mean, actually, this would be interpreted. This would be nice if it could be interpreted this way. Yeah.
Other questions? If not, we can thank you.